foams are a widely used chemical to fight and control wildland fires. But how do they work? How much should you use? And when does it become the most effective weapon in your arsenal? How do foams work? In essence, foams contain surfactants, that is, surface active chemical agents, that reduce the surface tension in water. This allows the solution to soak into fuels better than water alone. Foams have different mix ratios. Lower mix ratios mean thinner foams and faster drainage times, that is, the wetting ability. These solutions are better for soaking or wetting fuels, for example, in mop-up operations. 1 gallon of foam concentrate per 999 gallons of water is sufficient to lower the water's surface tension. Higher mix ratios mean thicker foams and slower drain times. The higher mix ratios are good for creating insulating barriers, for example, in protecting structures or log decks. Remember, as the concentration increases, so does the expansion, causing more foaming and slower drain time, that is, slower soaking. But contrary to popular belief, a thick foam is not required for wetting or soaking fuels. Foams can be used to fight a wildland fire by a direct or indirect attack. Let's look at both. In a direct attack, a foam solution or wet foam works best. The foam solution should be applied directly to the base of the linear flame front. And when you attack the edge, direct a portion of the foam stream onto any adjacent unburned fuels. On wide hotspots, secure the edges and move toward the center. Be sure you apply enough foam for extinguishment. As steam becomes visible, continue to apply the foam solution to wet and cool the fuel. Also, leave a foam blanket over the hot fuels to smother them and continue the wetting process. And don't forget to return to the treated area after the foam dissipates to check for any missed spots. In an indirect attack, the foam line should be at least 2.5 times as wide as the expected flame length. Wet the entire fuel layer so that the fire will not burn under the foam line. All foam types may be effectively used for indirect attack, but as the water evaporates, the foam loses its effectiveness. Thus, the effectiveness of a foam line in indirect attack is limited by the time it takes the water to evaporate, and the foam line becomes useless once the water has evaporated. To learn more about proper foam usage techniques, please refer to these websites. In addition to direct and indirect attacks, foams can be used for prescribed fires, structure and resource protection, and mop-up operations. Let's briefly look at each. When other barriers are not available, foams can be used to create a temporary control line during a prescribed fire and backfire until a permanent black line can be built with an ignition device. Foams used for this purpose should be wet and quick draining, that is, a lower ratio of foam concentrate to water. Depending on the brand of foam concentrate you use, start at 0.2% to 0.3% and adjust accordingly. Then, when you apply it, the width of the foam line should be 1.5 to 2.5 times the expected flame lengths. Thicker foams can be used to protect specific trees, such as seed trees, snags, and wildlife trees. They're also used to protect other resources and properties, such as log decks, wooden structures, and telephone poles. Treat surrounding fuels a distance of 25 to 50 feet out from the base of the object. In general, the more adverse the burning conditions, the shorter the time between foam application and ignition should be. The effectiveness and life of the foam blanket is also dependent on the foam's dryness and the depth of its application. At least 0.5 inch of foam should remain on all surfaces, even if an excess amount runs off. The penetration of the foam solution can be used soon after flames subside to extinguish the fire before it burns underground. This also eliminates residual smoke, reduces reburn potential, and minimizes soil erosion. When you conduct your mop-up operation, avoid applying dry, thick foam. Wet foams penetrate quickly to cool and smother, while dry foams can form a lid over the fire and trap flame and heat. Also, take extra care when applying foam to prevent the potential spread of embers from air movement created by the impact of the fire chemical. Having the right equipment is essential to delivering the foam where and when you want it. In addition, the equipment you use can influence consistency and structure of the foam. There are a number of systems to choose from. For example, proportioning equipment adds the right amount of foam concentrate to your water. Batch mixers use manual or automatic regulators. Aspirating nozzles use energy from a water pump to create low, medium, or high expansion foam, while compressed air foam systems inject compressed air into a foam water mixture. You can contact the foam companies on the qualified products list for specific recommendations of application equipment. Other fire equipment manufacturers or vendors could identify additional foam dispenser options. Regardless of what equipment you use, cleanup is essential. Foams are strong detergents, which may dislodge existing rust and scale and possibly clog equipment. So be sure to flush internal parts with clean water to help prevent potential clogging of equipment. Also, your equipment may require lubrication after cleaning. The USDA and U.S. Forest Service have produced a series of videos that discuss wildland fire chemicals in more depth. We hope you'll view each one to learn more about these important topics. You can also find more details on the Wildland Fire Chemical Systems website. Here you'll find information on safety, environmental issues, product quality, mixing ratios, aerial delivery systems, and other topics related to knowing when and how to use wildland fire chemicals.